What's up, everybody? Welcome to Real Time for the Real Everyday Movie Fan. I am Josh Williams, and I am joined by my good friends,
Ryan Murphy.
And I'm James Sheridan.
And thank you so much for joining us again, because we are here to give you our spoiler heavy review of Ghostbusters Afterlife. Now, if you have not seen it, please take a pause. I'll put a link somewhere here where our review is up right now on our channel, our spoiler free review. Check that out first. Go see it, come back and join us here in the spoiler discussion. But this will be your big final warning that we're going to talk heavy spoilers.
And you definitely want to go see this one without spoilers. There's some
definitely
really big moments that you don't want ruined for you.
Right. Good call, James. Yeah, because there's a lot of big things that happen throughout the whole movie that actually don't want to be spoiled for you. So yeah, please check out our review. We'll give you our spoiler-free thoughts. Now, before we move into this review, guys, I didn't do this in our spoiler-free review, but this review is sponsored by B&B Missouri Six Theaters. So we're going to take a brief promotional video here to promote them, and we'll jump right into our review. We'll be right back.
B&B Missouri Six is the premier theater to see a movie if you're in the Missouri area. The refreshments are delicious, the seats give you full reclining comfort, and the movie viewing experience is euphoric. But the main reason I wanted B&B to be my sponsor is their staff and the overall movie-going experience they provide. They're professional, friendly, inviting, and they truly have you leaving the theater feeling, as their motto goes, the magic of the movies.
Thank you guys so much for indulging us there. We have to give a shout-out to the sponsor. They take really good care of us, and we're hoping to eventually start expanding more and more in their company, but we thank them so much for everything they do for us. Now, we got all that out of the way. Let's talk spoiler talks. Now, we're not going to kind of rehash, especially if you've seen our previous spoiler-free review, not going to really rehash a ton of our thoughts before. We're going to talk about a lot of things we liked in detail that we couldn't really talk about. So just kind of give people caught up. What is your, let's just like go around Robin real quick and say our scores, and we'll move on from there. Mine, I'm still going to stick with a 9 out of 10. Ryan, what about you?
All right, I'm still going to stick with my 6.5 out of 10.
Okay.
Yeah, I reconsidered my 9 when I came out of the movie again the second time, but I'm still trying to hedge between like my unabashed love for Ghostbusters and trying to be objective about this film and see it for what it is and not just me fanboying about it. But
yeah,
I'm having a hard time doing that because like I can forgive so much when I love something. Which is not good all the time, but in this instance, like, I'm going to stick with my 9, but boy, do I want to push that to a 10.
Ooh, he wants pushed to a 10. Okay. All right. So we had quite a few things we, you know, liked and didn't like. Now I want to jump into one of the things that I really just loved that we couldn't really talk about kind of in, you know, without getting too heavy into spoilers. But we've got to talk about the ending, guys. I mean, that moment when Phoebe is fighting against Gozer, and all of a sudden you see this ghost hand wrap around hers, and it's fucking Harold Ramis's, you know, Egon. That teared me up instantly. Like, it would have been, to me, that had such more emotional weight for having to be between his granddaughter and him, rather than just him just showing up next to the Ghostbusters, the original three, you know what I mean? But to have it be like, it anchored more that it was such more of a family film than anything else, that it teared me up. And then also when you see that great shot of all four of them, just great shot all around.
That's the moment in the theater when that moment happened in the theater, when you see all four of them, I just thought, God, James is having the time of his life, right? Like,
right.
He will be. He was watching
it. I was already crying at that point. Like, this, like Josh said, the second his hand wrapped around hers, and he's like, to me, the moment is more about the family than it is about the original Ghostbusters. As much as I love that four shot, it was about, like, we've spent the entire movie developing this idea of this family who'd been abandoned by their grandfather and these grandkids who didn't know their grandfather. And this, especially this granddaughter who is basically like him reborn.
Mm-hmm.
Like she is not just the spitting image of him. She has like the same sort of mentality as him, the same sort of, I think that she has like the same narrative urgency that he does, which I'll get into,
right,
later on when we discuss more specifics. But like everything about her is exactly what Egon was, and watching him lead her on this journey of trying to solve this puzzle in his stead was such a joy. And that culmination of that moment of him, you know, being there to help her when she's clearly struggling against, you know, basically a god.
Yep.
And opening the door for the other Ghostbusters to come in and help was like, it's the culmination of everything. And just to me that, you don't talk that kind of moment.
And I wasn't even sure they were going to show him, because he was around, you know, because once he died in the beginning, he had like the ghost of him kind of playing chess with her, then showing her around. There was at least, you know, there was even a small part of me that was like, maybe it's like Gozer or one of the the gatekeeper or the keymaster fucking with her. But I was like, no, how they made it seem like visually storytelling wise, it was him. But like, I thought that's all we were all going to get. It's sort of a spiritual.
Yeah.
He's there, but not there. But the fact that they did that, that was pretty powerful emotionally. And then when they're building up this tension between his daughter, played by Carrie Coon, whose name was Callie, or
Spangler.
Yeah. Callie Spangler. And this whole tension between her and how she feels about her father. And then she saw the board, and then that hug at the end, that was a very, very emotional part. That's probably the hug
and watching him dissipate.
Yeah.
In front of all these people who love him, all of these people who now understand why he did what he did.
Mm-hmm.
It was not only just good closure for the story. It was closure for everyone who had grown up loving Harold Ramis. And it was our way of saying goodbye to him.
Yep.
Sorry, I'm getting choked up thinking about it.
Yep.
And they like panned up to the sky, and there was like the little four Harold at the end. And
yeah, that was good for, yeah.
Like, you guys didn't know me much. I mean, Ryan knew me, but I don't think he was around for the reaction I had when Harold died. I was gutted.
Yeah.
Like, I was gutted more than I was when Stanley died. And like, Harold was, you know, Stanley was part of my childhood. George Lucas was part of my childhood.
Mm-hmm.
Harold Ramis was my childhood. Yeah. I watched that movie endlessly, and watching one of my heroes die so young comparatively to, you know, it was heart wrenching just like to get to say goodbye, mm-hmm. and have that, like to see him on screen again. And oh my God, those effects are so good.
Weren't
like,
they? We talk about
the de-aging effects, and like they're often hit or miss. This was like, awesome. I couldn't believe how good it was. Mm-hmm. And I
completely understood why they didn't have him talk, because I mean, me too. They can do that because they may prove that in like Rogue One where they had Grand Moff Tarkin talking.
Yeah.
But I think it worked better just have him not, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I completely agree with you, James. Like when he died, it didn't hit me as hard because I did grow up watching the movie, but it's very similar for me. Like when Robin Williams died, that kind of broke me.
Yeah.
Like I that hit me hard.
For me, it was when Christopher Reeve died when I was in high school. I remember crying in the middle of class.
Yeah, same. And it was pretty hard when Robin Williams died. I mean, me and my wife, we were dating at the time. We had a huge marathon all weekend of watching anything that was Robin Williams. So I get where you come from. And just having them, how they did that, you can tell there was a lot of care behind it. And you know what I mean? So what?
There, we can see the reflection behind you, and there's like a head that's floating right behind your head. So it looks ghostly.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, peek behind the curtain, guys. I didn't pause it. I got the volume's off, but I got Doctor Who behind me right now. So
okay. I thought that was Tina's head. Like,
no, she, I thought it was something she already pulling up on walked by and gave me a funny look. So, you know, it is what it is.
It was, but just no, funny. We're talking about ghosts, and you just have this like ghostly image like bounce by in the back of the background.
It works, right? It works with what we're, you know, what we're reviewing and what we're talking about.
We're totally.
But I want to talk about what I, so when we were in our discourse, in our talk over Facebook chat and everything, when the final trailer came out and you heard Bill Murray's voice say, "Did you miss us?" And you just saw the image of like their midriffs and their hands. And James said, "I legit nearly cried." So for me, one of the highlight of the movie was actually like that moment when you hear, hey, Flat Top. That was like, before you even see them, just that moment, like, hey, Flat Top. And you know, it's coming. Cause I knew it was coming, you know, like, okay, they gotta be coming pretty soon. You know, they got the call, the guys, they're in trouble. And then, so I knew as soon as like Gozer was like crawling towards him, I was like, okay, here it comes. And then like, hey, Flat Top. And I was like,
it's the classic hero entrance.
And yeah, and then you see them, and then my second thought was, holy shit, Bill Murray looks like shit.
He's old, but, man. I mean, how old is Bill Murray now? He's got to be in his
70s now.
But so that moment was really cool to me. And then I like the four shot when they saw four of them. But like, and then of course, right after you see them, Gozer says, I figured he was gonna say it, you know, are you a god?
Come on, Ray.
Come on, Ray. Come on.
He's so disappointed in him. Did you not learn?
It really hit me like how long it's been. Like it really hit me like, wow, this is fucking old. They're referencing something really old. And here they are again after all this time. This is something that's my lifetime plus several years. You know, it's like, whew, it just kind of hit me like, wow, they're really coming back now. This is current after all this time.
Right.
It's really sort of a surreal moment. But
yeah, I agree. Cause we both agree they were in the 2016, but they weren't playing themselves. They were just more cameos of being, you know, regular people. They weren't really the Ghostbusters as far as the characters they were playing. So it didn't feel the same. But seeing them with the proton packs and everything and the banter going on between all of them, I will say for hardcore fans, especially for like James, the stuff that Ray said, you know, kind of his whole spiel against Gozer, it didn't quite hit me. Because I was like, all right, come on, you're rambling a little. I mean,
he's got to get his one liner.
That's what he does. That's his character.
That's the whole first movie, it's his character.
And I knew like hardcore fans would just love that. But for me, like, I don't know.
He's claiming to be part of the like fishing game wildlife. Like, he doesn't have any representation of them whatsoever.
Fishing game? What?
Fishing game? Like, oh, because, fishing because game. She's in a invasive species at this point,
right?
So and also it was James... really interesting seeing Gozer, even just seeing Gozer again.
Her redesign was awesome.
I love it so much.
I don't even think it was redesigned. It just looked the same as
the original was like bubbles.
It was supposed to be bubbles or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Whereas this one, like her eyes were much deeper and darker. Mm-hmm. Her hair and whatnot was like a little bit different, but like it was like spines and like scales and whatnot. Yeah.
And she actually lit up more.
Some fun facts for people. Gozer in this movie was played by Olivia Wilde.
I love that. I didn't realize
until you guys told me that.
And then a Muncher was voiced by Josh Gad. And
was it faced him too, or just voice?
I don't know. It just says voice. And then this is really interesting. The stand-in for Egon was Bob Gunton, but most well known for his role as the warden in The Shawshank Redemption. Also from Daredevil season one, various other things, great character actor. So I like to think the last thing that went through his head.
Oh, that was that him. Bullet, okay.
Was just how Andy Dufresne got the best of him.
You got to. So Ryan's probably going to be editing this one. I hope. Maybe he'll hook me up and help me out there. But he'll try and put a visual up for the fans, because once I looked him up, I'm like, okay, yeah, that actor, I've seen him in numerous stuff before.
So like obviously at the beginning, he really looked like Harold Ramis at the beginning when they had just had his face in shadow. I was like, holy shit, they got Harold Ramis back. But
another big surprise was Ivo Shandor, who was played by J.K. Simmons,
which is the most. All that really shows is that Jason Reitman, whenever he makes a movie, he wants to cast J.K. Simmons in it so badly, he will throw this character in there. Because J.K. Simmons, if you don't know, was in Juno. He was in Thank You for Smoking. He was in The Front Runner. He's probably been in other Jason Reitman movies that I don't know off the top of my head. But so he's definitely like one of his go-to guys. I did not see what point there was in that at all, but it was like, hey, J.K. Simmons.
That's my biggest issue. It's like, I really wish they had left Ivo Shandor, like have his name everywhere, but keep the mystery of him. Having him appear kind of ruined it for me a little bit.
And then
the joke of just him getting ripped in half almost immediately is like...
Which was pretty violent for a PG-13 movie.
Yeah. I mean, there was no blood because it was just literally a corpse.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, but yeah, I agree. I think having the mystery of him and not having him there,
like behind your head.
Right.
Like I would have liked if it was like the Tomb of Balin in Fellowship of the Ring, where it's literally just like the stone effigy sort of thing of him. And like, he doesn't rise up or anything because, you know, he's been dead for 75 years. And apparently, according to the tombstone, he'd been alive for 90 beyond that. So like, he's had his kick at the bucket, like, let him go.
James, why don't you go ahead with something you liked, and there's something I want to discuss between the three of us.
There's a few things that I really liked. For one, I really love, and this is more about the post credits, Okay. Which, if you didn't stick around for the post credits, I feel really bad for you. I love that they put back the deleted scene between Egon and Janine.
Okay, so that, okay, I wonder if that was a deleted scene.
Yeah, that's been around for a while. One of the fun things about this movie is that just around the time they started gearing up for it, and Jason submitted his script, Sony discovered a vault of old film material and found all of this old deleted Ghostbusters material that we'd never seen before. I was telling Ryan when we were watching the original Ghostbusters about the Fort Detmering scene. It was the only thing that survived of that scene is a single shot of Ray and Winston pulling up to it, which you can usually see on like the back of DVD covers and VHS covers. And then the infamous Ray having some jollies with the ghost. That was in a scene called Fort Detmering, where they were literally visiting this old fort. And for whatever reason, Ray decided to play dress up and then got fellatio in the scene. And the scene ends with Winston knocking on the door and you just hear Ray going, "Go away, man." And it's this weird, but like, I love that they unearthed all this stuff and that they used stuff. Mm. Like we saw in the YouTube clips that they were using alternate angles for like all of the news footage that was actually shot during that time and whatnot. And then of course, putting this scene back, but then tying it back into the point I was trying to make to begin with, Winston actually having some character development.
Yeah.
Because unfortunately Winston has been sort of, for lack of a better term, the black sheep of the franchise, in that like he's kind of a nobody and he never really gets much to do. One of my favorite things about the 2009 video game was that they made him a doctor and they made him an Egyptologist, showing that like in between the films and whatnot, he'd gone off and studied and was contributing to the team in more than just being a paid help.
Right.
That's no longer canon, but in this instance now he is a, you know, billionaire or millionaire, possibly a billionaire. We don't know.
He said worldwide company. I'm gonna guess billionaire.
Yeah. So he clearly has money. And like, I love that he himself is so invested in this company that he's left behind, but can't leave behind, that he's willing to bankroll it to become something new. I also love that they cut back to very last shot of everything was the old containment unit with a blinking red light and getting that.
I love that because it hints something's coming.
Not only is something coming, but something's still there.
Yeah.
And something has kept this thing running for 30 odd years now. And like, I'm wondering, because there's a throwaway line at partway through where Ray says they turned it into a Starbucks. I'm wondering Winston just bought the place and then told Ray it was a Starbucks to have him kind of like move on.
Right.
But he was maintaining the facility knowing that they can't let this echo containment unit die because there's too much stuff in there and there's nowhere else to put it.
Right.
The other thing I really wanted to address that I absolutely loved was the score, which may not mean anything to anybody else, but if you know your Ghostbusters score, they pulled so much from the Elmer Bernstein score to the point where like I could tell exactly what scene they pulled it from, because I could hear little beats like when they're chasing Muncher through what they called Rust City, the factory and all that stuff, the refinery, where they refine the selenium. That was actually the same beats. It's not the same score, but it's the same sort of beats and theme as when Dana's fridge, like she has her first encounter with Zool and you see the egg pop out and you can hear that little weird little
when it comes out on streaming, we'll have to get you to edit those back. Yeah,
dude. I'm not doing a good job of it. Like if you know the scene, you know the score I'm talking about, and the build up, and just I love that they did that, but it wasn't like just just recycling the cues. It wasn't just, you know,
well, just like
putting in the same old tracks. It's they rescored it, but it's like
it's I guess so what that's what I liked about it is that it played back to a lot of the original score, but it added its own elements to make it its own. Mm-hmm. It's kind of what the new Star Wars movies, the new anything new, like even the prequel Lord of the Rings kind of did the same thing. Anything that's really revisiting nostalgic original content, but still continue on with its own like storyline, essentially its own world. you kind of have to have a similarity to feel that connection. Mm-hmm. That's why I feel like having the score, having different nods to the original of the quote unquote nostalgia. I'm sorry, but you're in the world. In order to feel the connection to that, you got to have some similarities. You have to. And I
like also this. Like music is an emotional thing.
Yeah.
And a lot of those cues bring back the memory of those moments and whatnot. And especially if you're familiar with those moments, every time you hear the Fellowship theme, even though it's broken throughout the trilogy, you still get that sense of like this powerful team of people with a similar cause and whatnot. And you feel that swell of like, mm-hmm. they can do this. And like, even in the like darkest
even
moments,
the,
you just,
yeah, the even Force the Star Wars, Star Wars, even the Star Wars score, same thing with the new trilogy, no matter mm-hmm. what you think about the new trilogies, regardless, but they still used a lot of like original score kind of stuff.
Well, for me, this movie didn't have quite one of those, but we talk about musical themes coming up in really big moments when I'm going to sneeze. Okay.
God bless you, my child.
Okay. all of a sudden, Josh is a ordained priest now.
I am. But, you didn't know this.
Yeah, no, that's not accurate. so like moments when the score, an old theme comes up in a big triumphant moment. And trying to think some damn examples now. One thing that didn't get me quite the way that it got you guys, which I was hoping it would get me this way, but it didn't, because I didn't like the movie very much. I didn't like the moment very much, was with Mortal Kombat when he's about to stab right. him. And then all of a sudden Scorpion shows up and, you know, it's like, dun, 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 dun.
Right.
The equivalent of that in this movie would have been that when Ray says, or when Peter says, hey, Flat Top, could you miss us if the Ghostbusters thing would da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, like, which would have been right. inappropriate. But, you know, right. I do love those moments in movies when the score plays and you're like, I'm trying to think of another damn example now, but Godzilla, King of the Monsters, when the Akira Ifukube's theme plays when he comes up out of the water,
yeah,
stuff like that. So yeah, I don't know, totally know what you're talking about when it comes to the score.
Here's now, a little peek behind back the curtains. Just wanted to go back to the score very briefly. Something that a lot of people, unless you're an actual like very deep lore Ghostbusters kind of person, you may not know that there's actually two themes to Ghostbusters. There's the famous like Ray Parker Jr. da-na-na-na-na-na.
Yeah,
the one that everyone knows, played on the radio. You know, right. Who are you gonna call? Everyone knows that song. What you don't know is that there's actually a score with there's actually theme within the sure. movie itself.
The score.
Da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da. It's actually supposed to be the Ghostbusters theme. When you see the montage of them like going through the motions of like starting the business and learning how to like be Ghostbusters and they're doing all that, that's actually the theme that's supposed to be playing.
Huh. Mm-hmm.
And that it's a reoccurring theme. And I love that that actually played as Egon was dissipating and going away and replayed throughout this, is that it's sort of like a sub theme of the Ghostbusters. Gotcha. That people don't realize unless they've watched it 1,000 times like I have.
Huh. Never realized that. I didn't realize that was the actual. I thought just the theme was just the, I ain't afraid of no ghost.
Well, that was, they did the score and then the studio wanted to do, like, because the thing in the 80s was to have a hit song.
Right.
If your movie had a hit song, then, you know, you got free advertising on the radio. You got, you know, record sales. You got all this other stuff. You got, you know, an Oscar for original song if you're really good.
Right,
which they did get nominated.
Yeah.
I know they got nominated. I don't remember if they won or not.
They didn't. No.
No, and then like Back to the Future had them, and like you know Footloose, obviously, and like every movie in the 80s wanted to have a song, and Ghostbusters just happens to be one of the most iconic. But yeah, the sub theme is sort of like, I love that they played that into it. Anyway,
right.
Moving on. Well,
I think the only movies these days that keep up with keeping their own song is like 007. I think that's like the only one that ever really creates their own.
There's still
song.
Original songs.
Funny enough, there was an original song on this one too. McKenna Grace has a song on the credits. That's actually it's not part of the Ghostbusters soundtrack or score.
Hmm.
It's an individual track that she's produced. Well, I don't know who produced it for. I'm guessing Sony Records or something. But like, it's somewhat independent of the like. It's still themed on the regular thing, but like it's sold as its own individual track. So if you look it up on iTunes or something. Yeah, it's like
Haunted House or something like that.
Yeah, something like that. A ghost doesn't leave a haunted house or something like that.
That was her singing that?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
One of the things we got to talk about quick before we go any further, like what we liked about the movie. It's something we kind of discussed because I And I think some people may be wondering themselves, at least I was. So from what I've gathered from watching the movie twice, I'm probably going to see it actually again this week again. from what I've gathered, it seems to me that this movie completely ignores Ghostbusters 2. Just hear me out. Minus the store, minus Ray's store. So when they talk about, when they go back and they talk about, oh, you know, there, all this ghostly activity was happening and the Ghostbusters showed up, and after that it kind of just all died off. But there was a few years after that when they had the big, Statue of Liberty and all this other stuff happening, and then Ghostbusters 2. They don't really bring that up at all. They say, oh, you know, this happened at the tower and everything just stopped. So that's how I perceived that. Pretty much they are ignoring the events of Ghostbusters 2 and just talking, and this is just a sequel to that. Am I wrong, James, or not?
You're half right. I think it's intentionally left vague, because when they're talking about the time frame, it's, they specifically note that it's 1984 to 2021. They specifically note the 36 to 37 year gap from, am I losing you guys again?
No, you're cutting in and out, but
hello?
Yep.
They
specifically note a 36 year time span.
Yeah.
Okay.
God damn it. They specifically note a 36 year to 37 year time span, but when they're talking about, my internet connection's dying again, and I'm on my hotspot now. I don't know what's going on.
Huh.
I'm going to try this fourth time. When they talk about the time span, they talk about 30 years since the last ghost activity, not 36 years, which would denote the five-year gap between Ghostbusters and Ghostbusters 2. They're vague about that because they don't specifically note anything that happened in the film other than Ray's occult. And the only thing that really negates Ghostbusters 2 is the car, because it's not the newer modeled Ecto-1A. It's the Ecto-1 from the original film.
Right.
Now, you could arguably say that either there was you can't say there's two cars, but Ray specifically notes he took the Cadillac, the Ecto, meaning singular. You could suggest that maybe they tore off the extra gear and whatnot, but who knows? But I think they specifically and intentionally left it vague because a lot of us fans have been wondering, is Ghostbusters 2 still canon? So right. I think they're leaving it to interpretation of either the fandom or the next filmmaker.
Right. Okay.
Sorry. You just sound so much like you're drunk when you're cutting out. Or they're doing the other
thing. I still heard you. I'm sure the fans will too. It happens. I mean, we're doing this over the internet, folks, and it's live, and we're not really live, but you get what I'm saying. We're recording live. Ryan will probably do what he can to edit things out, but still, at least that's how I perceived. That could be probably left up interpretation. I think it's probably a good thing that they did. So we'll see, like, when they do a sequel, because of the ending, there has to be a sequel, and if it does well at the box office, there will be one. So.
Well, now that we're all done gushing about everything, oh, by the way, this gave me my wish, which is we see that Peter and Dana are happily married now.
Right.
So that was when she came back. It was like, well, what's the deal? Are they going to be like
that? But that whole scene. That whole scene where she's basically torturing him with the same electro device that he was using in college and getting revenge for that.
Right. That was pretty cool. That was pretty cool. And you can tell me and Ryan were both like really looking, at least I was like looking at the hands. Okay. Yeah. Looking, I see a ring, a wedding band
there.
There.
Ring on there? Oh, yes,
I see a wedding band there. Oh yeah. They're married.
They're married.
But I like how subtle it was. Like, it wasn't really in your face. It was just kind of a, you know, yeah, they're still married. Not still, but they are married. That's a good thing. Now, one of the things I wanted to bring up that I didn't necessarily like, I said it before in the review, there was a moment. So the moment when they're all in the cave and they're talking about, oh, this happens every so often every year. And then, you know, oh, my grandfather was right and this. They had that very dramatic moment. And then podcast comes in with this one-liner, kind of a crack a joke. I didn't really care for that. It just, I like moments like that to really let them happen. Like, let them actually, you know, let the emotion, let the new knowledge you got just kind of take place. And just having podcasts like have a one-liner joke in there just didn't work for me.
I'm not remembering the joke.
It wasn't really a joke. It was more like just a phrase, but it was like, it was meant to alleviate the tension in the scene. Yeah. Like movies do that. And this is the only time it actually, they actually did it. I didn't care for it personally. But that was really only my other really negative. Now, Ryan, you had something me and you talked about.
Yeah.
And maybe James can try and defend. You want to bring that part up?
Yeah. So basically I was not, like, my main problem with the movie that we brought up in our spoiler-free review, I said I couldn't talk about what I didn't like about the movie. And what I don't like about the movie is almost the whole premise. I mean, I kind of like the idea that they're out, their grandfather left clues for them behind and everything like that. But when you hold it up to scrutiny, the whole premise is based on, well, Egon Spengler took all the stuff from the Ghostbusters and, oh, he left us and went to some podunk town in Oklahoma and no one knows why, or he told us why and we don't believe him. It's like, this doesn't really work, because why would they not believe him? Like, he's literally like, hey, like the conversation is literally as simple as, hey guys, I literally have a open mouth to hell right here. You want to come see it? I have to keep crossing the streams and shaking the town to keep it from coming overflowing. I mean, there's all this stuff I can show you. I mean, there's really no scenario in which this would really occur, in which, like, because I think James, you said, well, he didn't really tell them all the details. Well, why wouldn't he tell them all the details? Like, he's just going to steal everything from the Ghostbusters and not tell them what's going on? Or if he did tell them, they didn't believe him, like, oh, whatever, you're full of crap, mouth to hell, I don't see it, whatever. It doesn't really hold up to scrutiny at all. And that was my main gripe with the entire film, is I just didn't really buy this whole premise that it was set upon. So, James, take that. James, Josh,
I hope my internet doesn't cut out here, because this, I do want to address this. I brought up earlier that McKenna Grace's character is like the carbon copy of Egon, mm-hmm. including yep. her sort of diagnoses, which mm-hmm. are not official in canon anywhere, but they very specifically hint at her being neurodivergent, possibly autistic. And some of the true attributes of being autistic is sort of the hyper-focus, the fixation on things, a very poor communication skills sometimes, very poor social graces. And we know that Egon had a lot of these similar sort of things. He wasn't good at talking to people. He wasn't good at communicating with people. And especially as he's getting older, and like they're indicating that he's a little more crazy and a little less sort of stable towards the end of his time with the Ghostbusters. I don't get the impression that he communicated to them very well what was going on and just sort of disappeared and then called them 10 years down the line to try to explain it, but did, like, was just a rambling sort of insane person. And they'd already kind of written him off because he just disappeared and took everything. And that was the end of the Ghostbusters. And like, they'd already started moving on from that. And mm-hmm. like Ray held it as sort of a burden of like anger for a long time, which is a little out of character for Ray, but not really, because he Winston says at the end, Ray is the heart of the Ghostbusters, and he is a character of all heart.
Right.
He loves everything wholeheartedly and he jumps into things wholeheartedly, but he hurts very deeply. And right. I think the loss of Egon moving away like that, just suddenly without telling him really what's going on, not communicating it very effectively, really kind of hurt him to his core. And we see that in like the way he reacts, that he says, you know, Egon Spengler can burn in hell. And then the next minute, well, he's dead. And he's like, you can just see like 30 years of just anger wash away. And he's just shattered.
Right.
And he's just heartbroken. And I don't think that Egon was in his right mind when he was telling people these things and trying to tell people what the problem was. So they didn't really have an indication until 30 years later, the kid calls him and says, he was right. Something is going on here and we can't solve it. And then
yeah.
they get cut off. So they can't resolve this issue, which is a very deliberate plot point. And the kids are kind of on their own, which allows for the moment where the Ghostbusters swoop in to save the day. Kind of the kid still ends up being the linchpin, which I liked. They didn't just solve the problem for them, but
right.
It may not work for you. It worked for me. I don't have a problem with it the way it's written. And I can totally see where it's coming from. I do wish they had to flesh out a little bit more about him departing, just to make that make a little more sense and communicate it a bit better. But right. for what it is, I don't have a problem with it personally.
Yeah, and I kind of agree with that one, with that, James, kind of your sentiments on it. Like, I see where Ryan's coming from. It definitely, it's there. It's a little loosey goosey with it. But that goes into, like, you know, knowing knowledge of character and stuff and kind of spanning, you know, throughout the movies and whatnot. But also it could have been explained a little bit better, but I see where you're coming from, Ryan, but I kind of agree with James. And in the same vein, the kind of problem, I wouldn't say it's a plot hole for me. It was more of a plot dip in the ground. Like, you know, starts the ground of the plot mm-hmm. was for me, we kind of talked about this, like, with Ghostbusters 2, how everyone just kind of thought it was all fake and it was all a hook. I'm like, well, this just happened like 4 or 5 years ago. There's no way you can just say, oh, this never happened. It's
right.
I call BS. This one kind of does the same thing, but then I go, well, I can't really, so much has happened.
Yeah.
From the time of 1984 up to 2021.
But that's the thing is, like, I don't.
Now, the only reason I can be okay with it, because if you look back, there's some, like, even today's kids, even for me personally, like, when you think of stuff that's happened, like, in the past, like, Pearl Harbor or the Two Towers falling in 2001, people know it happened, but they don't really know about it. So it's not really in people's minds. Now you can't say there's that in the Stay Puft Marshmallow Land. It's like, you know, this is something supernatural, but that's this thing, like, society's brain, especially after a long period of time has passed, you don't really remember a ton of it, even if you believe it or not. And if you don't know
especially
about it,
especially when there's been no ghosts for 30 years, like, that's kind of a big point in the favor of the plot point, is that, you know, there's been nothing happening for 30 years. If it was a reoccurring thing, then it might remain in the zeitgeist a little bit more. But as it is, like, Finn mentions, or the character Trevor mentions, that he's heard of the Manhattan ghost stories, but to him, they're just stories. And obviously Mr. Gruber is very familiar with them, and mm-hmm. podcast is sort of vaguely familiar with it.
Vaguely, yeah.
So it is still in the zeitgeist, but it's like 30-year memory gap.
And
like,
that's, they said, why it
happened 20 years before these kids were even born.
Right.
You know, these things are forgotten sometimes. And it, like, unless you're watching those tapes relentlessly. Also, if Ghostbusters 2 is still canon, there was a very deliberate government cover-up of this, where they blamed the Ghostbusters and said it was just this mass hallucination where, like, nobody saw what really happened on the building. The only thing that you can really point out as obvious is the Safe of Marshmallow Man, which I can't really explain how they would explain that away, but the story point that Ghostbusters 2 is kind of establishing is that, you know, they sowed enough doubt that people have kind of moved on from it, sort of in a 9/11 kind of way, where, like, you know, we have people who, I mean, we're living in the middle of a pandemic and people doubt that exists, even though there's, like, ample evidence all around us of that. People still doubt it exists, and it's like,
yeah. And so that's why I gave it a little bit of a pass, because, like, you know that kind of thing can kind of wisp away in people's minds, even if something supernatural. And even then, like, with this going on, like, even though Egon moved down there so early, all this supernatural stuff didn't start happening until 2021. That's how visually it's interpreted, is that every year the mm-hmm. stuff, like, the gates open for Gozer to come through. And then when they, you know, when it does, you know, takes over. But during that year, all the supernatural stuff happens to help build that power to Gozer, to, in order for her to come through. Because Gozer, and this is what I loved about the storytelling, more of Gozer, is that not only do the Keymaster and Gatekeeper have to mate, but they still have to be the dogs. Like, they have to become human, mate, become the dogs again, open up the gate. And then actually Gozer is what's, them two still being dogs is what's keeping it existing
in this realm.
So when they took, I think it was the Gatekeeper, Zool, when they took Zool, that all of a sudden she was like, Gozer was half there, half not. Yeah. That was great storytelling to me, because I didn't know that from the original film, but that's how it was. You know what I mean?
I don't think that was ever established in the original film, just that they had to open the gate for Gozer to come through. And I love that they've embellished on those points of the original without actually having to explain much of how that worked, because we already have the original to tell us that. And they kind of just took for granted that. It's not like they kind of gave brief explanations, but like, we've already been through this story, so let's just get to the point kind of thing, which I loved.
And it's not only just them, but it's also the all the ghosts and everything like that from that pit also powers Gozer as well. Mm-hmm. So that
because the pit is powered by the sacrifices of the townspeople over decades. Yeah. And I'm still unclear about what the inciting incident for this return was, like why 2021 was important and why 1984 was important. I wish that had been explained a little bit, because all the other points seem to have some sort of, like, you know, they mentioned like a great big volcano and like World War II, which was obviously, you know, massive amounts of death and very much, you know, a lot of occult sort of peppered into Nazism and all that stuff.
And I don't want them to continue on with Gozer as the main villain if the movies progress, but I would love that to be more explored. Because like they even say, like, you know, why this town? Like, why here? Why not somewhere like, you know, Florida or something? You know what I mean? Like,
Shandor needed the selenium from those mines.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah. But, and like, first of all, that's the other thing that really bugs me is okay, like, going way back to this event should be more well known. It should be more well known. I mean, you can make excuses like, well, they're kids and blah, blah, blah. Like, no, like this is some big shit. And even if the kids aren't necessarily aware of it, like, kids might not know who Keith Richards is, right? If Keith Richards moves into Somerville, Oklahoma, like, someone's going to fucking recognize him. Like, hey, you're fucking Keith Richards. Like Keith these Richards? Guys are really... Who the fuck? All right, bye.
Hang on.
He's the guitarist for the Rolling Stone.
Oh, my bad. Okay.
What am I doing here? What am I doing with these people? Like, this is fucking insane.
My bad.
Okay,
see, that's the thing right there.
If Justin Bieber were to move to Somerville, Oklahoma,
I'd move.
Said who's Keith Richards? You have no fucking right anymore to say, "Oh God," when I say mention Justin Bieber. Like, you are now a millennial. Like,
you're a millennial too, dumbass. Yep. Yeah. Anyway.
Oh yeah, I just got called dumbass by someone who said, "Who's Bill? Who's Keith Richards?" Anyway.
Who is Bill Richards? I don't know Bill Richards. Is he an accountant?
Yeah.
Moving on.
So anyway, like Egon Spengler, like this is a huge fucking thing. This Ghostbusters, this crossword book of 1984 is a huge thing. Like a marshmallow man walked down the streets of Manhattan. People know the Ghostbusters, or at least they would in any sane world. If Keith Richards moves into a town in Somerville, Oklahoma, not everyone's going to recognize him, but eventually someone's going to be like, "You're Keith Richards," like not dirt farmer, you know? And like people, like, I wish they'd have shown, like, they showed YouTube stuff, which was kind of fun. They had like incorporated how YouTube is in our culture now. Like, I wish they'd shown their Wikipedia pages and, like, you know, shown like who Peter
was.
Like,
but was it established that their names were household names? Like,
that's what I'm saying. It would be.
I don't think
1984 is a big deal. And Ivor Shandor.
Again, the government buried it, though. They blamed these people and they went away. Can you name
that's like, citing Ghostbusters 2, which, as Josh has said, isn't really factoring into this. But Ivor Shandor would have been maybe not a household name, but enough so that people would have been like, someone in the town would have been like, Ivor Shandor built our whole town. Like, no, wait a minute. Ivor Shandor is the guy who built the apartment that hell broke out of. Like, oh.
But you're assuming that they would know that. How would they know that? Why would they know that?
Because this crossword of 1984 was a huge deal. You know, we know who Osama bin Laden is because 9/11 is kind of a big deal. People know who orchestrated.
Osama bin Laden and 9/11 have affected our culture for 30 years or for 20 years now.
Why? Because it was a big event.
Can I finish? We didn't stop the war on terror that stayed in the zeitgeist for this long. The implication is that this died out in the 80s. People forgot about it. People moved on from it. So I understand that you're not accepting that premise, but there's nothing to say that the Ghostbusters are household names. There's nothing to say that Ivor Shandor would be a household name. They had to dig into the deepest trenches of ghost lore to find that name originally. And the only reason the kids found it was because Egon left like a plethora of books out and the kid knows what to find. And he probably guided her to it. There's no indication whatsoever that Ivor Shandor would be famous outside of this small town for any reason. Because they know, because this event occurred, everybody knows every aspect of this event. Everybody knows who was responsible for it. 30, 40, 50, 60 years before
even if everyone occurred. Doesn't know it, even if everyone doesn't know about it,
he had nothing to do with the actual event. He died in 1945, 40 years before the Ghostbusters event even occurred. Nobody would even connect that besides the Ghostbusters, because it was such a deep, like, Ghostbusters know their lore. They know their ghost stories. They know mythology. And they had to look deep into their, like, deep, deep, deep lore to find this name and to figure out what was going on. And all of that, why would the regular day person know any of that? Why would that be a common thing?
Because they did discover, they dug deep and they found it, and then they became very
famous. And who published that information? If only the Ghostbusters had that information, how did that get out?
That's what I'm saying, is my assumption at this point in this world, when I come into this world, yes, I know, my crazy assumption is that when a massive event like Marshmallow Man walking down
the street, you're holding it against the film because of your assumption. There's nothing to indicate any of these things occurred in this
world. I'm assuming it because there's something to indicate it. That's where assumptions
come from. What is there to indicate that these things were household names?
Because the giant Marshmallow Man walked down the streets of New York.
And that has nothing to do with the names of the Ghostbusters. Nobody in the town knew Egon's name. They just called him the dirt farmer. They had no idea who he was.
Right.
Why would they know he's a Ghostbuster?
Because he did something very famous. Like, that's like, you could honestly say
10 years before.
You could say the same thing about Keith Richards. Okay, Ryan, he played guitar really well.
Without looking it up, name the terrorists on 9/11. Besides Osama bin Laden, name all the terrorists.
That's, come on.
Come on.
You're saying that that's on the same level as, like, just knowing the names
they
of the
were involved, weren't
the
they?
Ghostbusters were famous.
Were they not involved in 9/11?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they should be common knowledge then by your account.
If there was only four of them, they probably would be. Absolutely.
Except we know that their names are out there. I could look them up right now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So they are out there. Why do you assume that everybody would know the Ghostbusters by name? Why should Evo Shandor be in the common vernacular?
I've just given
you reasons why he wouldn't be, and you're completely ignoring that.
Because I'm just not buying it. I'm sorry. Like, that's gonna be an impasse.
Wish I had popcorn for this one, but well, I have to agree to disagree with that one, guys, because that was pretty good. I wish I had popcorn. Seriously, I was like listening to you too, just kind of. But I mean, you got to agree to disagree. That's one of those moments where it could really go either way as far as the fandom is concerned and the fans. Because you got one side or the other right there. I kind of fall in the middle where I can see it, but it doesn't bother me too much. Not enough, because everything that else that happens outweighs those things for me, at least for me, like all the greatness else that's in it outweighs it. I'm sorry. One of the other great things was honestly the chemistry. Kind of, let's shift away from that a little bit. Let's talk about some of the things we saw that were new. And I actually liked, because we had talked about nostalgia and having too much forced nostalgia. And I think this one had rode that line really well. One of the things I loved is that I know some people may hate that the Slimer wasn't in this. I actually liked that he wasn't.
They just had a Slimer ripoff instead.
Well, they created a whole new ghost for like a whole new generation to kind of give them something new. And I actually really thought
think he'll be the same thing as Slimer, though.
No, but I loved the new creature that you said was voiced by Josh Gad.
Josh Gad, yeah.
It's basically like a metal eater. I don't know what it was like, because the Slimer ate food. This thing just ate metal and objects. And
Slimer ate anything.
Yeah, but it actually just like projectiled the stuff back at them. I thought was actually kind of cool. I don't know. I liked that they created something new for a new generation, essentially, because that maybe could be the new Slimer for this generation. Another thing, I remember I said before in the review, and I wanted to get your take, James. I liked how they kind of repackaged the slime in this, like more of like a glow to it and a different color glow. I liked it. I liked the new look of it. Why didn't you go for it?
I mean, I don't have a problem with it per se. Just it didn't look real to me. Like that was one of the few effects that didn't work for me, because it looked like it was like they literally, like, because I know what they did. They cut part of the shape out and then, you know, produced this sort of glowing embery slime on it. And that, like, I just like the like clear food thickener slime that they've always used. To me, that's just
right.
That just works. In fact, like the cartoony version of the slime never worked for me, and the pink slime in the second one didn't work for me. I just like the clear viscous liquid that looks like snot, because that's kind of the recurring joke, is that it's snot or other bodily fluids.
Right.
I don't have an issue with them doing it this way. And it only really seems to like be like a muncher kind of thing, as far as I can tell. I don't remember any other ghosts having that same sort of impact, but the only reason it didn't work for me is because it looked like a sort of bad effect to me.
Okay, fair enough.
It didn't bother me. Speaking of things that did bother me, one thing that I do wish they had a... So we were talking about this beforehand. In the lead up to the film, they released the toys. And one of the chase toys, well, sort of the Build-A-Figure toy was the Sentinel dog.
Yeah.
Which someone had to point out to me afterwards was actually the dog in the trap. Originally, I thought it was one of the two gatekeepers.
Right.
So I wondered where the Sentinel was. And like, you can see when he's even approaching.
Uh-oh. I lost both of you now. I got this really weird look on Josh's face. Like,
bipedal instead of a quadrupedal monster. But then he just disappears. And he has no plot relevance at all after that. And it seems to me like Egon would have gone after him for a specific reason. And I feel like that's a dropped thread. And I really want to know more about what was going on there. Because again, like they were teasing that. That was like a big part of the sort of like lead into this, was like, look at this cool chase figure that we see as like a character popping out of a trap and then never again. And it's like why, if you're unleashing your hordes, why would you, like, why would he not factor into the final fight? So I feel like there's deleted material
because I agree with you, I don't like it either. And the only thing I can think of is because that they had to have made a much longer movie, and so this is probably one of the things that was cut. So my fingers crossed is that we'll get the director's cut.
Yeah.
A much longer, kind of filling in those spots, because I agree.
Jason does director's cuts.
I don't think so, but hopefully, like, if fans want it, you never
know. Time for everything.
Yeah. So like, that's the only thing I think of, is that that was probably one of the things that was cut from it for time. Yeah.
He's also never made a movie this commercial before. So I mean, like,
true. So
that could be one of the things about that, but that's like, to me, it's just sort of a lost plot thread where it just disappears and doesn't play into it. Cause it's like, again, Egon capturing it to me would have been, because initially I thought he captured either one of the gatekeeper or the keymaster, which to me would have more played into the plot, where you can't open the gate without one of them. You need both of them to open the gate. So if he's holding one of them, you can't open that gate. Gozer can't come through. It's end of story. Which to me would have been the simple way to solve this problem, is capture one or both of them, put them on opposite ends of the world, bury those damn traps, which is why I had an issue the first time I watched it with him leading his granddaughter to this trap, which she could very easily unleash. And it's like, well, now you're letting go of the thing, but now I understand it's the Sentinel. It's not one of those two. So that's not what the plot was doing, but I'm disappointed that the Sentinel was teased and then just never happened again. The other thing that kind of bugged me about this is, like, we praise the performances, and a lot of the performances are great, but there's a couple of characters that feel kind of almost useless. Like, for the most part, Finn's character feels sort of like a chauffeur, and that's Trevor. Trevor's sort of like a chauffeur throughout the film, and he doesn't really do much of anything else. Like, he's got a little of action at the end, but like, as a character, I don't feel like there's any sort of growth to him, that he's not really sort of like a much of an older brother to the sister. And like, they make points early on to kind of like say, like, the mother's asking him to like look out for her, and he's like coaching her on, you know, tell me your jokes and whatnot to try and get her to be more socially popular, which is a recurring plot point, but he kind of disappears throughout the film when it's not involving the car. And I thought that was disappointed. And then the character of Lucky is almost useless. Just like, I love the character, but besides getting into the police station, she does very little. And then she just ends up being another victim of Zool being possessed and completely gone for most of the climax. And it's like,
They never even follow through. Does Paul Rudd get the girl? Does Finn get the girl? She says she has a boyfriend, and then she never so he's going to have to compete for her affections and with this boyfriend who never shows up, and apparently just, I don't know.
Or the other kids that they establish early on as being like personalities, and then they just disappear for with it, which I don't have as much of a problem with.
Nah, me neither. Because that to me that fills the world essentially. Like, in your own.
But I still feel like
and through your own eyes, like you have your own, like in your eyes is your own movie. So you'll have those, so, you know, those people mm-hmm. that kind of just pop in and out quickly with the one-liners in your life.
Yeah.
That's how I kind of viewed it. So
I would have liked if they had done like an ET thing where she wrangles the other kids to go and get involved and like distracts people so that they can steal this stuff kind of thing. So that like they're like, you put the gun on the mantle of these kids who clearly have a personality, they're clearly characters, but they're not name characters. So like, let's have them do something later on kind of thing.
Right.
And then Carrie Coon's character is good, but I feel like I wanted a little bit more from her. Like I know it's the mother daughter or the father daughter kind of thing, but I feel like most of her role is just being angry at her father. And there's not so much, like, she's not really that good of a mother, and she's not really, like, she's not there for her kids, but what is she doing? Because she doesn't seem to have a job. She doesn't seem to have much of a life outside of the kids, but then, like, she's not there for them. And it's like, I don't understand what, like, and she doesn't have to have, like, a job or anything. Just, I wanted a little bit more for her to do in this film. Like, she's just sort of there to be the emotional weight.
Yeah, I get it. I get what you're saying, but I kind of push back on a little bit. Just, I feel like that emotional weight of that, because you see that very often with someone who feels abandoned by their families or by their parents. They'll hold on to that forever until there's something clicks at that where they were wrong. And that's, I love that emotional levity when she sees that map.
Sure.
But someone will hold on to that forever. And now as far as the being there for your kids, I mean, she was kind of fixing up the house. Like I viewed it like when I was a teenager, I hardly saw my mom. I saw her in passing.
Sure. What I'm saying is I'm not expecting her to like to unload this, like to be okay with everything. Like the emotional burden is fine. That's her role in the film, but I wish they had done a little bit more with her somewhere else in the film. She'd be involved in something else. Like the kids is just an example of like something else they could have done with her. She's just kind of there to be angry and that's it. And well, I'm kind of disappointed by that, because Carrie Coon is a decent actor. Like she was
amazing in Gone Girl. If you haven't seen Gone Girl, she's pretty great.
Carrie Coon was in Gone Girl.
Yeah, she played Ben Affleck's sister, twin sister.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but
well,
besides,
we know how
I mean,
James feels about Gone Girl. So
yeah, he doesn't like Gone Girl. I love Gone Girl. I think it's amazing.
To be fair, I haven't seen the movie. I can't judge the movie. I just hate the book so much. I refuse to watch the movie.
But she was also there for that romantic relationship with Paul Rudd to have some sort of connection there.
Yeah.
And, you know, with that dinner scene, I like you explore a little bit more of her. And, you know, because she seems like she's kind of going through the motions of life, which most people are, especially if you have two kids and you're by yourself. You know, you're trying to provide for your kids as best you can.
Yeah.
But I did like how, you know, their connections will eventually led them to becoming the gatekeeper and keymaster. So I don't know. I get what you're saying. Like I said, it's one of those things where I see it, but I actually liked how that was done.
Yeah. This franchise unfortunately has an unfortunate history of undertreating its characters of color and its women characters. Like the women characters tend to just be there for like a singular purpose kind of thing.
True, but not this movie. The face of the movie is actually Phoebe.
But I do wish the other women.
Yeah, Phoebe.
I do wish the other female characters in this had a little more to do. And I do wish that Lucky, we don't even know her name. She doesn't even have a name. True. She's just a nickname. I mean, if Lucky's her actual name, then fine. But like, to me, that sounds more, but it sounds like a nickname to me.
Yeah.
No, but like, if it's her actual name, fine. But it's like, there's a problem with women just being like single name characters, or like one of the big arguments you hear about The Big Bang Theory is that you don't learn Penny's name. She's last just name, Penny. She doesn't have a last name. She doesn't have like much beyond just the boys kind of thing. So I would have liked to see, like, and these are minor nitpicks. Like, again, I'm giving this a 9 out of 10 where I really want to give this a 10 out of 10.
But guys, we're missing the huge point here. Who won the chess game?
I'm sure Phoebe would have won.
Never finished the chess game.
No.
Like, that was something that I really.
That was really special. I love that. Yeah. I love that moment.
No, it was the perfect plot point. It was the perfect sort of like framing point to get her into this without scaring the hell out of her. Like the minute like she sees the thing slide across and her science brain goes, okay, I've seen this. I can't explain what it is. I'm going to observe and actually like try and interact with it and try and figure it out, because most kids see, you know, chess piece move across the board. They'd run out of the room screaming, right?
Yeah.
It would not be something that, you know, you'd be okay with, but this kid of science who previously in the film had said, you know, I don't believe in ghosts, suddenly encounters evidence. And it's like, I must engage with this evidence and find out what's going on. Like, she's the, you know, she's a scientist. And it's,
that's what I love the most about the storytelling of this, the script and the character development is all done organically. And it's all done through, not through just exposition. Like, there are a couple exposition points, but you have to have that for people who don't know, like the characters who don't know what's going on. You have to do that. So that's still kind of an organic way of doing it instead of all just standing there talking like, but you all, cause you all, you know, some movies you have, they all know what's going on, but they still stand in a circle and talk about it.
Yeah. It's like, it's the, as you know, scene where like,
yeah,
everyone's knows what's going on and they're talking to each other. It's like, this scene is stupid. It doesn't make any sense. Why would they be telling, why would three Ghostbusters be telling each other Ghostbusters lore? That's why you have Winston in the original film. That's why you have Lucky and Finn in this one. So that Lucky and Trevor,
Lucky and Trevor,
you have podcast and Phoebe to explain it to them. And I love that scene because it's very much the prison scene.
But even for the original character development, like with Phoebe, I love the moments where, you know, he's like, hey, maybe your mom and Mr. Gruberson are, you know,
are going to do it. Gruberson's trying to bone your mom.
Yeah, that scene. And then she kind of sits there puzzled. She goes, yeah, you know, I don't really display emotions, but inside I'm throwing up. Or the moment where they're going after the Slimer in the building. And he goes, why aren't you freaking out? You know, she goes, well, overstimulation calms me. And it's like, that's me is great character development, great knowledge of the character and their mindsets kind of thing. I don't know. That's
and to both me of those, both I, of those really are my love. Cues for why she's neurodivergent, possibly autistic. I don't know. Like the stimulation thing makes me think ADHD, but she tends to display more autistic tendencies. But I love those little
touches. Right. So let's kind of wrap up our thoughts here. If you guys have anything else before we wrap up this review, as far as things you liked or didn't like.
Ghostbusters sucks.
But we can all agree that
running out of the room before James can get here from Canada.
James, you have something?
I mean, so many things I could talk about.
Hey, this is the movie he's been waiting for 30 years. James, do you have any final thoughts in the next 5 minutes?
I'm going to have final thoughts for like 10 years from now, probably for the rest of my life.
That was what I was getting to next. That's what we can hope for. Cause right now this movie has done $44 million, at the box office here in the US, 60 million overall, but they're still going to be opening throughout the next month in different territories. So there's going to be more. And actually, they're hoping for a good steady throughout the coming up here in Thanksgiving break. Yeah. So they're up actually for a good second week. That's what I'm hoping for. Because if they get decent money with this, I mean, because this movie had an $80 million budget. If this thing could make at least $300 million, you're guaranteeing a sequel. Guaranteeing.
Gone you got to imagine another movie.
$80 million for promotional purposes and stuff like that. But if we, especially with the ending, we got to see we're going to get more stuff out of this. And I'm hoping that they still stick with Phoebe and Trevor as the leads, sort of, you know, at least Phoebe.
They're going to have to age them up a little bit, unless Winston and Ray are going to be like training them.
Yeah.
Which I'm really hoping not, because I don't know if that's.
And podcasts. You got to put podcasts in there too. I love the kid. Logan Kim was
that
awesome.
Was one of my favorite, one of my absolute favorite moments. First of all, podcasts zapping all of the goddamn mini puffs was an amazing scene, and him coming out just covered in the marshmallow was a great throwback. But when him and Ray meet, and he finds that Ray is the one subscriber to his podcast,
yeah,
because that is so perfect for both their characters, because Ray would be the one person to listen. Like, I worked on several like low budget cable shows that did like haunted stuff, and Dan Aykroyd promoted them, had nothing to do with them. Yeah. Just found them on Twitter and promoted them, and it blew my goddamn Ghostbuster mind. Because like, he'd have no reason to talk about these things, and it's just like, oh, you should watch Haunted Hospital tonight. I'm like, okay,
right. Yeah. So that will be hopefully our dream, is that they'll continue going within this world. And I still like the idea of kind of handing off the reins, and they can be like little coaches or whatever, and still be in the Ghostbusters building. But still having Phoebe for me as the head of this new franchise, I am all for, because she carried this thing with grace. She was awesome. She was a badass. She was very charismatic. Even there was lack of chemistry. Even there was lack of charisma in her character, she commanded the screen.
But they made that work with like the recurring, like her trying to make jokes kind of thing and trying to connect with people. And like, I literally laughed out loud when she made the joke to Zool, not because she made the joke, but you can see she's got her little hand at her side and she does a little jazz hands.
Yeah.
She's trying to sell the point. And it's just, oh, it was so perfect.
But you know what I mean?
Little so things I want to hit on before we wrap
up.
Yeah. Proton packs look great. I love the advancement in the technology.
Yep.
I love that they advanced the car because the car could not drive in the previous films. And we
saw
this one taking leaps.
The tech too.
They explored the tech. They've obviously advanced the tech. They've aged the tech.
Yeah.
There's the new Polaroid and the ghost visor. There's, you know, the gunner door, the remote control ghost trap, all that stuff is great. The product placement, which has always been sort of a problem in 80s films, and I love that they just like not only like dove into that, like they had obviously they pulled the crunch bar out of the pocket and there was Twinkies in the glove compartment in the right. background. There were like the Cheez-Its, which were always, you know, Egon's favorite snack. And there's little other things like the toaster from Ghostbusters 2 is in his kitchen.
Oh.
The dancing toaster from Ghostbusters 2 is in his kitchen. Doesn't canonize it, just saying that it's there. Maybe he just had an affinity for that brand of toaster. I don't know. But the implication from Ghostbusters 2 is that he slept with the toaster.
Interesting. I did not realize that.
Death Whistle was made by Adam Savage, formerly of Mythbusters, because he got to do like a lot of behind the scenes stuff on this. Nice. So if you check out his page, his tested page on YouTube, you can see a lot of that stuff, including how he made that. And he got like behind the scenes look at like the props and all that stuff and built, you know, a sort of screen replica one himself based on the props that he saw from the film with one of the guys who made the props. Trying to think of other things that, the eye ghost people may not realize was actually a nod to one of the toys. He popped out of the storefront like the eye popped out and then the rest of them came along. That was actually a toy from Kenner in the 80s, which is a nice little throwback. So many great Easter eggs, so many little moments. I know people complain about the fan service, but it's like, it's that stuff that like thrills us and, you know, we love and it's like,
And also
car,
as long as
I just love the car, the siren, I cried when the siren came on because that damn thing is iconic.
When did you start crying in the last scene? Did you start crying when they showed up or when like
when Egon's hand touched hers?
Mine too. I teared up when that happened.
I flailed when they showed up because like, I did my little neurodivergent excitement flail. And when the hand touched hers, it's like, oh my god, it's actually Egon.
It was
earned. It's the spitting image of Harold Ramis, and it's like all those like one of the things going into this was all the Ghostbusters fans were like, how are we going to address the elephant of the room of lack of Harold Ramis? Because how are you going to tell a Ghostbusters story without Harold Ramis? Because peek behind the curtain, he wasn't just Egon. He also wrote the script. He was a big part of the comedy. He was a big part of the character development. He took Dan Aykroyd's insane, batshit crazy treatment, grounded it, made it realistic, and made it funny and made it smart. And made it fun, and he's the one who pulled all of this lore and brought everything in, and like he is the voice of the Ghostbusters. So to say goodbye to the character, the actor, the voice, all of this, just it was a perfect way to kind of, and it, like I love that in the first 10 minutes we see him die, we get an explanation of how he died rather than it just being him gone kind of thing,
right?
And that he died for a purpose and he had a reason for doing this, and sorry, my mind is racing like 200 miles an hour trying to like pull things here and there out. Like just so much I want to say, and like I'm going to think of them in like 15 minutes after this and I'm going to kick myself and like, can I have this team to like, I got to think more, I've got more thoughts, and can we put the, and guys, and can we, and there was this and there was that and this thing.
James, here's the best part of that then. That's when you jump in those comments down below in this video on your personal YouTube page and throw down some more of those positives. So James, wrap it up. Like, what are you looking forward to hopefully in the future? And what, like, we all know that you just absolutely love this movie. Just give us your final thoughts and kind of pitch to the fans why they need to go see this again.
I mean, if you're at all, 'cause
people have already seen it and they're coming here, but why go see it again?
If you're at all a fan of this franchise, you need to go see it because, the franchise is going to depend on this. 2016 was such a bust. We've had so many false starts. If you want more storytelling in this universe, this movie has to make money. Sony's already sort of waffling on the idea. They want this to succeed. Mm-hmm. We need to tell them that we're behind this. I don't care if you didn't like 2016. I don't care if you don't like this movie. Go hate watch the fuck out of it. Please do it on my behalf. Do it for like just to spite me kind of thing. Like whatever the motivation to go see this movie, please go see it, because we are not going to get more without this film doing well.
Right.
And I know Josh and Ryan are like kind of chuffed about the numbers. I'm still nervous about the numbers because there's still budget to make back. You've still got to make at least double the budget back for it to be a success. And Sony, unfortunately, Columbia has a history of saying, like they said, the original Ghostbusters didn't make any money, even though it was one of the biggest films of 1984. They have a way of like writing these things off on paper. So this needs to make money. And I'm not usually the kind of guy to say, you know, something needs to make money. If we want more Ghostbusters, this needs to make money.
Right. I can agree with that one there. And I think this is definitely for repeat viewing. It's just a great time at the movie theater right now, especially for the holiday break. It's got great heart to the movie. The whole cast as a whole is great. More specifically, McKenna Grace. I mean, we all, if you've seen it, I think you can all agree with that. But just repeat viewing is like right there. I'm going to go back and watch and look for that damn toaster. I didn't realize that.
I don't know if it actually appears. I know they put it on the set. I don't know if it's actually in a scene. I'll have to look it up.
Have to look.
It should be there somewhere.
Yeah. There we go. I'm sorry. My camera is doing stupid stuff. But regardless, guys, I think this is easily a repeat viewing type of movie. It's a great time at the movies, especially if you've seen it and someone else you know hasn't. Take them to the movie theater. They'll definitely, I think they'll find some form of enjoyment out of it as far as the action or the comedy.
Take your kids.
Take it, yeah.
As much as this has jump scares and whatnot, Ghostbusters deserves a kid fandom.
Yeah.
Because it carried them in the 80s. I mean, you can see right back there. I still love that shit from the 80s. Like, I chased those figures my entire adult life to find them because I didn't have these originals when I was a kid. And it's like, it's recapturing part of my childhood and seeing them bring back not just the toys, but the proton pack and the PK meter and all this stuff. And a buddy of mine who I went to see it with said he got all the stuff for his, and like a full jumpsuit for his 4-year-old son for Christmas. And he's like, I want to give it to him now. He's more excited than the kid is. And it's like, I want kids to be able to enjoy this. Star Wars has had its resurgence, you know, Marvel's had its resurgence. You know, all of these things that I grew up with have had their comeback and whatnot and stayed in the zeitgeist. Ninja Turtles has had several different iterations. I want Ghostbusters to be there for a new generation.
Same.
And take your kids.
Yeah.
Cover their ears during certain scenes. You'll probably know when they're coming, but
once my daughter gets old enough to really focus on a movie theater besides like Onward, I'm definitely gonna take her. I'm definitely gonna have her watch it at home and everything like that. So yeah, definitely. Ryan, what about you? Your final thoughts on what you're looking forward to?
You always make me give the final thoughts if I'm the least enthusiastic. No, I mean, I you know, it's if you like the movie, go see it again. I feel like I've already fulfilled my obligation because I paid twice to see it.
I'll make me drive down there and make you see it again, Ryan.
Well, you're gonna have to get a visa, foreigner. But I feel like I've already filled an obligation because I paid twice to see. I haven't told you guys this yet, but I had to go to the bathroom halfway through, and I was not about to leave and come back and miss part of the movie. So I just
bought a
ticket and went to a different screening and paid $26 altogether for this experience.
Wow.
So I feel like, you know, I've already done my part. But take your kids by all means. I mean, my sister would not be caught dead taking kids to this movie because they say things like bone your mom and stuff like that. She's like really strict, so this is not for her. But
take your normal kids. Sorry, that's offensive. I apologize. That's me.
Okay, she doesn't support me or watch my things.
No, but that's it's just cruel to someone else's values. I don't actually mean that.
Yeah.
But no, obviously, for me, the big draw, if I were to go see it again, I don't know if it's $13 worth. I really try to avoid going to theater whenever, unless I absolutely have to. But for me, the big draw is the hey, Flat Top, and the, you know, everyone coming back again and seeing Bill Murray spout one-liners again. And that was kind of a big moment. I'll definitely get it when it comes out on streaming.
Come on, Ray.
And yeah, yeah, I'll definitely get it and rewatch that part like a million times. It's kind of like almost like the Cap. How many times have you rewatched the Captain America?
The portal scene?
The portal scene, or just the hammer scene.
Yeah.
Just the hammer. Yep. like, da-da-da-da! Okay, rewind. Da-da-da-da!
Oh yeah, every time I load up Endgame, it's like it's at one of those two points.
Yeah.
So we're then they're right next to each other. So it's so that's my main draw is to see this again is because I'm not a Ghostbusters fan in the sense of what James is, but I do enjoy the first movie. I do recognize it's so what?
I said few are.
You are. So you know, like I do recognize its legacy, and so it was really exciting for me to see those guys back after all. I really love these legacy sequels as long as they're not Terminator Dark Fate or Star Wars The Force Awakens, as long as they don't completely destroy and sodomize the legacy. Like if they just come back and respect it and have people bop back after decades, it's good in my book. So
it's funny because coming into this, I was totally expecting you to call this The Force Awakens of Ghostbusters.
I thought you were
felt like it hit so many of those same points, but it's like,
yeah,
I love both those movies. So
you went into this like with like, oh man, I was such a terrible day Friday and blah, blah, blah. And we thought you hated the movie. And I thought you were going to be like, I finally see what Ryan feels like about The Force Awakens. This is that to me, but no, you love it. So, it does repeat some of the same, it's not almost like The Force Awakens. I won't insult it like that, but it kind of, they beat the same enemy in kind of the same way again, in sort of that respect, but it doesn't beat the dead horse in the way that The Force Awakens does. We won't get into that right now. So, hey, guys, what did you think of Ghostbusters Afterlife?
Yes. Well, Ryan, we're not going to get into that argument. We can go on for that one. But, yes, more importantly, guys, what did you think? Give us your spoiler thoughts in the comment section below. And also, if your score has changed or if you haven't left your score, leave it in the comments and let us know what yours is as well. Also, if you like what you watched, hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, drop a comment, share the video so you can receive all of our greatest content in the future. And thank you so much for supporting us. Sharing the video, liking the video helps support the channel, helps get that more into the eyes of the search engines as far as the algorithms go on YouTube and Facebook. So please, that would be a great help to us. We really appreciate everybody who follows us here on YouTube and Facebook. Also, just letting you guys know, we'll put it up here again in the spoiler review, but Ryan has an amazing interview with Stephen A. Morrow. Is it Morrow or is that how you say it? Morrow?
Yeah, Morrow.
He is the sound mixer for Ghostbusters Afterlife, but he's also done some incredible films before. A great interview Ryan conducted there with him. So check it out. You will not be disappointed. But again, that is for today. I'm Josh Williams.
I'm Ryan Murphy.
I'm James Sheridan.
And thank you for keeping it real.
With real time.
Did you miss us?